you now. Somebody better get a shout on, because you don't know what tomorrow is going to hold. Somebody pray. Glory.
To Riley Field, there would be a multitude of people out there just come to see her knock somebody else down again. So about right after high school, we parted. I don't know where she went, but I went to St. Louis too. And St. Louis was rough, real rough. But where we come from on Chicago, it was real rough too. But that ain't what I was looking for. So a number of years passed by, and the next time I seen Sister Haney, amen, it would have had to been around 1990, somewhere right around in there. And a number of years had passed, like I said. And all I could think about was, you know, how she was when she was a young lady. And now she's a missionary. And I didn't know much about the church, but I knew that at least she couldn't knock us down no more. But inside her, it was still there. You didn't want to deal with her the wrong way, because she's going to bring it to your attention. Amen. Well, that's Sister Haney, you might as well say it. Amen. Some of us still like that. Amen. I mean, no, God, he takes us just as he intended us to be. And when he examines your heart, he might see something that the rest of us can't see, since man only look on the outward appearance.
Cares are past, I'm home at last. There are several passages of scripture that suggest that what we are dealing with now, ladies and gentlemen, is the beginning of sorrows. When you have, even today, we're going to have a continual epidemic of citizens now turning toward policemen and shooting and killing, like what just happened in Ferguson. We're going to find that these sorrows we are dealing with are going to be too much for the average man. Our teenagers are losing it. Our adults are on the verge of losing it. That's supposed to be types of examples for our youth. They too look like they're on the verge of collapse. Jesus spoke a parable in St. Luke chapter 18, to this end, that men should always pray and not to faint. Well, the big problem is now, folks are not praying like they should. So Jesus said the inevitable is going to take place. They're going to collapse. That's what the word faint means. They're going to collapse under pressure. Homes are disintegrating. Marriages are falling apart. Churches are reeling. In fact, ladies and gentlemen, let's deal with politics for a moment. We have more crooked and divided politicians in the White House, Capitol Hill. The last year of President Obama's presidency will be the worst year he has ever experienced in his life. And it will simply be because he is supporting agendas that are abominable to God. You can't be for same-sex marriage and God be for you. But that's where we are. This year that has just come in, you're going to see an increase of a change of fashion. Clothing stores will be geared toward homosexuals, and very difficult to find masculine clothing because men are those that are behind the clothing line are also of that gender. Now, what that has to do with the citizens in this country? Well, the fact of the matter is we are increasingly becoming like the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. In fact, it's so normal now until we can't even hear preachers preaching much about it anymore for fear of losing their congregations. For fear of losing membership, thereby causing their paycheck to be cut in half. We're there. These are the beginning of sorrows. The best time to literally be taken out of the earth is at the beginning of sorrows. God did my sister a favor. And I believe, according to the word of the living God, we are just to behold trouble like this nation has never known of sorrows. The storms we just had up and down the eastern seaboard cost this nation over $1 billion just for a few days of snow. How did that factor into the citizens of this nation, and how does it affect us? Well, the fact of the matter is the next thing to go is the economy. Many of you sitting up here now, living, becoming maintenance men and women. For the most part, you just live to pay bills. Only a few have accessories where they can go on vacation and take a break after a tough time in paying bills and taking care of their overhead. The rest of the folks are not just that fortunate. They're to the point where they have to have uppers to get up and downers to lay down. There are some folks sitting here that can't sleep past 3 hours every night because of the demands that are on your life. The demands are so strong and so furious. The word of God says that men's hearts will begin to fail them because of perplexities. Perplexities means that you have so many trials and troubles and don't have answers to them. You're just full of trouble every day. And so he says, are inevitable to take place. A solar eclipse is supposed to take place next weekend, which means trouble is coming to the whole nation. I'm talking about nations of the Gentiles. Some of you are sitting here right now and have no idea that within 7 days, you're going to have a solar eclipse according to the NASA's report. This is a sign from God telling the nations of the Gentiles, look out, because trouble is coming your way. Well, I don't want you to get so disturbed about it, because some of the king, take me to the king, And I don't know about you, but somebody else in here ought to tell the Lord, Lord, oh, Lord, I'm ready. When you call my name, oh, Lord, I'm ready. Whenever you call me, whenever you call me, all of my trouble will be over. If you're not right, you need to get right. It's time. It's time to stop playing these games. Can I get me a witness? Yeah. One of these old days, you got to drop your mortal and put on immortality. But don't worry. Every child of God, there's going to be another family reunion. Can I get me a witness? When we all get to heaven, what a day! What a day here! What a day! Oh, rejoicing that will be. Say yeah! Look at your neighbors and neighbor. Her cares are past. She's home at last. Her cares are past. She's home at last.
And every time that happens, something devastating happens in the Middle East and something happens around the world. So I want to say to you, with all that lieth within me, to be in the world but not of it. Just like God protected the Israelites in Goshen, He still rained down hell, fire, the frogs came out, lice, cankerworms, caterpillars, all of that still ate up the Egyptian crops. But it never disturbed the camp where Israel was. So I want to say to you, there's some devastations get ready to come to America. I'm just telling you. The last year of the president's office, in president being in office, is going to be the worst year he's ever experienced in his life. His standards, so busy trying to go along with what everybody's doing and be popular, he's gotten away from the commandments of God. And as a result, you're going to see even him aging quickly. Because you cannot, God does not hold up even a body of someone who's walking away from God. Even our youth, you can see they're deteriorating. When they're not walking with God, they look just as old as you do. Amen. And they're only half your age. You know, but they're rusting away. When the presence of God is not on you, then there's no preservation. Right. So I say to you, do all you can to walk before the Lord. I have several scriptures I want to bring out on today. And if you can't find them instantly, just write them down, please, and read them. I just believe I'm here today by divine providence. I'm on the way to Michigan to preach Bishop Allen's workers' meeting. And then from there into Toledo and back home. We ask that you continue to pray for us, because where we're going, we're trying to really get God's people ready for what is to come. You're currently in what we call the year of Jubilee. If you're taking notes, it started in September of 2014. It will last up until the 28th of September of this year. The year of Jubilee is a year of rest and restoration. How many of you can stand both of them right now? Come on, raise your hand. Rest and restoration. You remember Jesus said to the crowd, "Come unto me, all ye that are exhausted from laboring, and I'll give you rest." Well, what he was suggesting is that you can move from a life of exhaustion
to that of relaxation, but you have to do it God's way. Praise the Lord. Be tenacious. That means to keep on keeping on no matter what it feels like, look like, seem like. Be tenacious. Write down Genesis 12. God called Abraham and told him, get out from your country. Get out from your family. Sometimes your family can be your worst enemies. And being good, and that's God. He says, thou knowest the commandments in verse 19. Do not commit adultery. Do not kill. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Defraud not. Honor thy father and mother. This is what we call a brief description of the Ten Commandments. The first four commandments deal with treating God right. And then the next six commandments deal with treating your parents right and treating your neighbor right. If you treat God right, your parents right, and your neighbors right, you're going to have a good life. One false move in those Ten Commandments, you can alter the other nine. Right, right. You can't treat me right until you see God right. Right. When you see God right, then you'll learn to, first of all, treat your parents right. All you that's getting ready to get married or thinking about getting married, go to the man's house, see how he treats his mother. If he's yelling at his mother, just put yourself in her shoes. And then tell him, could you take me home, please? And don't ever worry about picking me up again. Amen. So, you know, all of the evidence are laying right there in front of your face. You just have to look at these evidences. Don't get so wrapped up in your emotions until you miss your evidences. Amen. So learning how to treat God right is important. Learn how to treat your parents right is important. And then your neighbor as yourself. Then at that point, you're in great shape to enjoy the land no matter what the politics are, no matter. Oh, my. You know that deserve a praise. When God blesses you, he wants you to get up and bless his name. All of these ungrateful people come setting up in church with crazy attitudes, coming to church mad. I was mad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Hurry up and get it over with. The NBA, you know, that's on. And then after a while, in the fall, is the NFL. And let me get me through here so I can go watch the game. If you don't hear them cut the prayer short, I'm tipping. Yeah. And don't know nobody on that field. Nobody. Yeah. Nobody. Amen. So look at the next verse, verse 11. Look at the first word. What does it say? Now, that means a warning. Come on, somebody. But the warning is not about anything bad as it relates to the land. He says here, beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God in not keeping his commandments and his judgments and his statutes, which I command thee this day. He says that's the thing you need to be aware of. When I start blessing you, you lose the address to the church. He says, when I bless you, you get in the car. Now you don't know how to drive to the church. Huh? Now that the Lord done bless you with the house, you don't want to come out to go to church. He says, beware. Beware. See, folks, there's some folks sitting in here. They can't handle no blessing. Attitudes change. Nose shoot up like a helicopter. Straight up in the air. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Won't have talk to nobody. Won't have speak. And you, what you got on, you got it on sale. So why are you acting so crazy? All right. Now here, look at verse 12. Lest when thou hast eaten and are full and you build goodly houses, see? But you see that? Dwell therein. That means you enjoy the house so you won't even come out of it. All right. He says, your herds, your flocks be multiplied, your silver, your gold is multiplied, or multiplied, all that thou hast be multiplied. Then what happens, ladies and gentlemen? Your heart be lifted up. And what happens after that? You forget the Lord thy God, which brought thee forth, let's just say, out of bondage. There's some folks sitting in church still in bondage. No wonder your praise is so short-lived. You are no greater than your worship. If I worship every morning, I have to. I worship the Lord for his goodness. If I don't worship in the morning, I feel like I don't even want to go out the door. Do you know how much trouble is it? You know how much favor you need on God every day of your life? Come on, somebody. And you're sitting in church like, this ain't for me. Oh, what you come for? This worship is for crazy people. And not, I'm enjoying y'all today. Now, you'll never reach the palace talking like a peasant. Like I said, watch the people around you. If when you pick them up and they're riding with you, the only thing they're talking about is problems, drop them off. Just drop them. Say your ride just ended right here. Right here. Get out. You're killing me in this car. Get out. Come on, y'all know somebody ought to shout behind that. You pick these people up and they're just dumping a whole load right in your lap like you ain't got enough you already dealing with. Yes, sir. Make a sharp left and throw them right on out the car. I got one more scripture and I'm going to be done with y'all.
Coming down your face.